Okay, let's get to the tough stuff. 2014, most of it lies ahead. Where will we see AEA stepping out? Where will we see your best efforts over the next year in particular?
In 2014, AEA is focusing not only on the NextGen GA Fund initiative and partnership with them, because I think it's very important that we keep spreading the word that that mandate's approaching rapidly, much sooner than we all think. And it will really benefit the pilot community to investigate what they need for their upgrades and make an appointment with their avionics shop to talk about those upgrades and the cost of financing and get their slot in line for their installation. So AEA will really focus on promoting the NextGen GA Fund. We constantly monitor regulations, not just within the United States, but since we are an international organization, we have regulatory representatives stationed in Australia, Canada, Europe, and soon into Latin America as well, to assist our VP of Government Affairs, Rick Perry, with keeping up, as you can imagine, with all the various countries' regulations. That's always, you know, in the top three of our agenda items every single year is regulatory representation. The Part 23 rewrite, now thanks to congressional legislation, hopefully that will soon become a reality. So we will be keeping on top of that. The list is endless. I think what's exciting is we're seeing some really positive signs pointing to a market recovery that we haven't seen in the last 8 years for 2014 and beyond. I don't think it's all going to come at once, but as long as we can continue these upward trends in various areas of the avionics industry, it's going to keep the AEA pretty busy.
Is the FAA as much of a partner as they've been in the past, or has the bureaucratic morass kind of kept them from being what they need to be at this point? Is that part of the problem?
In some ways, I think it is. You would probably ask 4 to 5 different industry people that question. You're probably going to get 4 to 5 different answers. Where I see it, where AEA chooses to focus our efforts for this coming year, is more regionally. Mm-hmm. I think we're getting more progress and better feedback from the regional offices and from the ACO offices and from the various directorates. So we're going to focus our attention on building those relationships because they are out in the field. They understand, I think, better our challenges with our members, whether it be certification or installation approvals. AEA has been hosting, along with GAMA, the General Aviation Manufacturers Association, a series of avionics rotorcraft forums. And we're about to host our 5th rotorcraft forum 2 weeks from now. We'll be in Dallas, Fort Worth at the Rotorcraft Directorate, where we're bringing industry together with the FAA Directorate, setting down for 2.5 days talking about challenges and issues. So I think on a more regionally or directorate level, we're going to have bigger gains and hopefully much more success than trying to work directly out of the headquarters office.
What can you tell the general aviation community, the folks that are using this gear, about the state of the avionics industry and the confidence that they should have and may indeed be able to count upon in the future in where this industry is going, how it's going to be able to serve them, and the additional capabilities coming on board as we head toward 2020?
I would probably tell them that there will continue to be great things coming out of the avionics manufacturers. They're so innovative. Safety enhancing features to the current technology, improvements on glass cockpit and flight management systems, more and more improvement back in the cabin with in-flight entertainment systems, cabin management systems. We're really starting to keep pace with the consumer electronics industry. Our avionics manufacturers are becoming very nimble. Obviously, they've always been creative and gifted in that arena. But with the enhancements and the additions to existing technologies, I think that's what we're going to focus on in the next couple of years. Obviously, enhancements to ADS-B technologies to make it easier, less expensive for aircraft owners to equip as well.
So I guess the ultimate message of this is, as many challenges as we have, we've done awfully well overall as an industry.
Right. I think it's the spirit of the industry. I think it's the people that make up this industry, our passion. Our passion comes first. As I will remark in my State of the Association address this week in Nashville, we may be crazy, but we're crazy in a good way. We don't just give up and call it a day because I think we believe in what we do. Whether you are building airplanes, whether you are building avionics, whether you're servicing and maintaining an aircraft, whether you're reporting on the industry, whether you're flying the airplane, we all share the same passion, and that's our love of aviation.
Keep doing what you're doing. We need it, and more important, it's just a fun industry to cover right now, and we thank you for that.
We appreciate you being here. Thank you very much.
Aero TV is brought to you by... Since the early days of powered flight, pilots have struggled with landing in crosswinds. In fact, crosswinds and wind gusts cause more landing accidents than fog, thunderstorms, and icing combined. That's where the Redbird X-Wind SE comes in. By placing pilots in gusty crosswind conditions for extended periods of time, the X-Wind SE gives instructors all the time they need to teach the pilot the proper techniques for landing in crosswind conditions. For more information on Redbird X-Wind SE and Redbird's entire line of flight training devices, visit www.redbirdflightsimulation.com.